Okay. Recording in progress. All right, got it.
Hi, Film Festival's audience. We are very happy to have Ron Tucker. He is the festival director of the Beaufort International Film Festival. For those of you that are not from the US or South Carolina, this is a beautiful country by the sea between Savannah and Charleston, I believe, or so.
Yeah, that's correct. We're about halfway between Savannah, Georgia, and Charleston, South Carolina, and we're kind of a smaller version of both of those cities.
Right. And that is, you're heading towards the 16th edition this coming February. What are the dates? Remind us.
The dates are February 22nd to the 27th. And it will be our 16th edition. And looking forward to it.
All right. Are you the founder?
I am. I'm the founder, created in 2007.
All right, tell me why and how you started the festival.
Well, prior to 2007, I was a location scout. I was a director of documentaries, a producer of documentaries. And we made documentaries about the Marine Corps, the United States Marine Corps. But I was also a location scout for movies and for catalog companies and photography. And we had, Beaufort has a long history of films being filmed in Beaufort. Beginning in 1978, we had The Great Santini. Then along the way, we had Forrest Gump was filmed here almost entirely, and The Big Chill and Prince of Tides. The last film that was shot here was in 1999, which was the Rules of Engagement with Samuel L. Jackson and Tommy Lee Jones. And then all of a sudden things stopped. The movies quit coming. We'd had a good run. So in 2004, I presented an idea to our county and city leaders to start a regional film commission. And when the film commission was started, I was selected as the chairman of that film commission. And I went to film commissioner training, became a certified film commissioner, and then came back with the idea that we should start a film festival. Said if we can't get the filmmakers to come here on their own, let's have a film festival, and then we'll get them to come here as part of the film festival. So that's how it all started. That was in 2004, and it took us about 3 years to get it off the ground. And in 2007, we had our first festival.
All right, now 16 years later, what are you most proud of, and what are the biggest difficulties in putting this festival on the map?
We really banked on the history of the film industry, having been here in Beaufort, thinking, even though it's a small town, we could make a film festival. We didn't have the idea that it would be an international film festival in the beginning. In 2007, I had no idea what to expect. None of us had any experience with putting on a film festival. So we learned pretty quickly what goes into it. We made a lot of mistakes that first year. We had about 500 people total show up for the festival. It was a two-day festival. And now 16 years later, we are a six-day festival. And our last pre-COVID year in 2020, we had 17,000 people here in Beaufort. That's more people than we have in the city of Beaufort. You know, we only have 14,000 people, but we had 17,000 at the festival, and that was pretty remarkable. So I guess the biggest thing I'm proud of is the fact that it's grown so much in those 16 years. And really it's through the word of mouth through filmmakers who have come to Beaufort, enjoyed the experience. They fell in love with the Southern hospitality of Beaufort, and they tell other filmmakers. So people are making movies and trying to get into this film festival.
Right. I noticed you have a couple of awards regularly. Can you name a few of the past honorees and those of 2022nd edition?
Some of the past honorees we've had at the festival, we had Andy McDowell. McDowell was here in 2015. She got the Spirit and Pride of South Carolina Award. She's from South Carolina, and she came here, and we presented that to her. In fact, author Pat Conroy presented it to her. He was a resident here before he passed away. We had Vanna White here 1 year, who got the same award. Powers Booth, the character actor, very well known, played Curly Bill Brocious in Tombstone. And we've had a lot of people behind the scenes type. Arthur Schmidt, who was a film editor for Forrest Gump, actually won the Oscar for Forrest Gump. And he also won it for Who Framed Roger Rabbit. He was here in 2014. And Tom Berenger lived here for a while. So Tom Berenger has been to the festival several times. So we've always had a lot of kind of behind the scenes folks that are here. Eugene Gerty lives here. He is a sound designer, won the Oscar for Hugo, and does a lot of work with Martin Scorsese. So we've got quite a few folks that have been here and have told others. And we're proud of that.
Sure. Just a personal note. I remember, I was a distributor before running Sony and Fox, and I released The Prince of Tides, which shot in your town, in your area. I released also a magnificent film, kind of a cult movie, Groundhog Day, Andy McDowell. And I do remember she spoke quite well French, as far as I recall. And Yeah, and when next you speak with her, because I see she's in your board, try to have her pronounce Beaufort the French way, which is Beaufort. You know, it's also the name of a very good French cheese.
right.
Beaufort, yeah. Which you can age for, let's say, 2 years, and that's a better solution.
Right.
And Todd Berenger also had in one of the movies. So tell me now about the Beaufort locations. I mean, in terms of where you screen, do you have a multiplex? Do you have a screening room dedicated, or how about?
Well, we don't have a multiplex. So one of the things that's unique about our festival is we have all of our screenings under one venue. We only have one screening per film, so there's not multiple screenings. So if you miss it, you miss it. And the screenings are held at the University of South Carolina Beaufort Campus Center for the Arts. It's a performing arts center. We have a capacity of about 400 plus people there. In 2020, we averaged 411 people per screening, and that was starting at 9 o'clock in the morning and going to about 11 o'clock at night. So we have probably one of the most devoted audiences I've ever seen. We have people come from all over the country to the festival. And we took, we had a festival last year. We had a scaled down version, but—
In person or hybrid?
We had an in-person. Our festival happens in February. So February of 2020, we were one of the last film festivals in the country, maybe in the world, to have an in-person film festival, because on March 15th, everything shut down. So we went the whole year, and then as the new year approached, we thought we could probably pull it off if we were extra cautious. So we had to go with a limited capacity. We greatly reduced, almost 50% less, but I personally called all the filmmakers that were selected that I could reach and ask if we build it, will you come? And they said, yeah. So we had 50 plus filmmakers. We have over 50 filmmakers show up in 2020. So we had fewer attendees, but that was okay. But the filmmakers were here and had a great in-person experience. And we had a few world premieres, and it was a probably a little more intimate setting because it was smaller, but it was pretty successful. We had no reports of positive COVID cases when I got back home. So it was pretty good. And this year we're building back up to where we were at the 2020 level.
So what can the filmmakers that have been selected to your 16th edition expect? Do they have Q&A? What can they expect?
Well, the interesting thing about ours festival is that we do have the blocks. We have things broken up into the blocks. It's a two-hour block. So whatever we can fit in the 2 hours, it may be four shorts in that 2 hours, or it may be a short and a documentary in that 2 hour. But at the end of that 2 hours, we break. But within that block, every time they have a screening, we build our structure so that there's a Q&A immediately after each screening if the filmmaker is here. If the filmmaker is here, as soon as those credits roll, we go on stage and we talk about the film. I tell the filmmakers, it doesn't matter how long your film is. If your film is 5 minutes long, you've got 10 minutes to talk about it. So we get on the stage and we talk about their film. And usually the audience gets engaged and I have to kind of pull the hook to pull them off so that we can stay on schedule. But and this year we have about 90% of the filmmakers already have committed to coming. So we don't have that many filmmakers that are not coming. So that's a lot of Q&As.
Right. And what about the Southern welcome? You said what kind of treats do they get? I don't know, what's the specialty around the crab or cakes or whatever? It's just on the entertaining.
The food here is great. It's seafood, a lot of seafood. The shrimp is a mainstay here, and crab. Shrimp and crab, crab cakes. We have a thing called it's called a low country boil. This was sausage and shrimp and potatoes and onions. And most people leave here a few pounds heavier than when they came. So even though it's a winter month, but the food is one of the great things about coming to Beaufort.
And do the filmmakers meet the local community? Are they kind of events where they can mingle and understand the local customs and stuff?
Yes, we have an opening night ceremony. On the opening night, we do not have an opening night film on purpose because that is our networking event. You know, we have a lot of people from the community come. In some cases, that's the only thing they come to is the parties. But they come to the party, they meet the filmmakers. The filmmakers are distinguished. They have their own separate lanyards. So all the lanyards don't look alike. The filmmakers have one that says they're a filmmaker. So it's easy for the audience to gravitate to those people and ask them questions about their film. We'll have media here. So we do a Facebook Live and sometimes a YouTube Live, which we plan to do again. But it's an opportunity for them to get to know each other. And immediately after our two-hour opening ceremony, then there's several of the local restaurants. All of our activities are within walking distance. So they all go to the different restaurants, bars, and they continue kind of the networking. And then we just hope that people show up for the movies the next day. So so they get to party.
It wouldn't be long enough to hang
over. Right. So, and it works out, it has worked out for us for 16 years. So we figure we're not going to change it. So it's a great time for them to meet and greet. And then when they come on the first day of screening, they all seem like they know each other and they support each other. They want to see each other's film. Now, whether that's because they're there to support or they want to see what the competition is, because they're all in competition for their respective categories. So it's a lot of the community really turns upside down for them. They look forward to it. It's their first festival. We have a lot of festivals in Beaufort, and this is the first one of the year. It's in a winter month. The weather is starting to get warmer, so the people who came to us came from places that are still extremely cold. We have a lot of people coming from Canada this year who are looking forward to being here, a little warmer climate. So it's a little bit for everybody.
Good. I love hearing what you say about how you try to make filmmakers network, meet new people, new peers, and understand the local community. Now, maybe a little bit, can you tell us a little bit about this year's lineup? Do you have what kind of sections did you have a theme in mind, or what led you to this programming?
Well, we have several categories. We have feature films, documentary features, documentary shorts, short films, student film, and animation, and we have screenplays. Each one of those films, they're competing with each other in that category. And of course, at the end, we have an audience choice, or the audience gets to vote for their best of fest, more or less, is called the audience choice. And we have a comedy section, and the audience gets to vote for that. So they get to pick which one they think was the funniest film. But in the selections that we have this year, the other thing is because we are just a 6-day festival, only 4 of those days are for screenings. The opening night day is our opening ceremony, and we don't have films. And our closing day is another case for them to kind of wrap up, and we have a reception and the award ceremony, but no films on that day. So in that time in the middle, the filmmakers are here, they're supporting each other, and they are really watching each other's films. And a lot of time it's the filmmaker who asks the questions from the audience, which is great, and part of their learning experience. But at the end, there will be one winner in each category, which will be announced on our awards night. We have kind of a Hollywood Academy Award kind of atmosphere for the awards night. We got to kind of do it the same way. It's pretty glamorous, and people dress up, and it's a lot of fun. And when people leave here, they swear they want to come back. So, and they they do. We have 15 world premieres this year, which is that's a record for us. We've never had that happen before. Someone asked a question the other day if COVID hurt us with submissions, and the answer to that would be no. We had the second most number of submissions we've had from about 40 countries, and we only select 53 films. So that's a lot to get in, and it really comes down to the total runtime, what we can fit in, which is why we don't have more. We concentrate on short films. We have about 30 short films, and then the rest are a smaller number. So
how many submissions did you say? Sorry, how many submissions did you say total you received this year?
How many
submissions? No, submissions.
Submissions, we had about 400 submissions. We've had more than that before, but that was when we had student films and we made it free for them to submit. We decided we would never do that again because we got films from everybody in the world, just about. But that's a manageable number for us. Some festivals get thousands, so couldn't handle that. But what we get pretty much is really, they're really competitive, and we have to not select a lot of great films. And that's really the sad side of that, because we only have so much time that we can have. And in some cases, we encourage filmmakers when they're making the films, if you're going to make a short film, for example, don't make it 39 minutes long, make it 15 minutes long. And that really helps us in programming.
Do you have any panels or keynotes in the meantime, during the festival?
What was that question again? I'm sorry.
Do you have panels or keynotes about God knows what?
Yes, we're actually having one of our discussions. We have a screenwriters workshop because we started that because we felt like screenwriters that were submitting their screenplays didn't really have anything to feature. We didn't do anything for them. So we created a workshop where we have a person who chairs that department, and he contacts the screenwriters, and we ask them to select 3 to 4 pages of their screenplay that best represents that screenplay. And then we have a group of local actors that will take your screenplay and will act it out during the workshop.
Really? Nice.
And they sit in the audience and they watch the unfolding of their screenplay based on what they had submitted. And then the other screenwriters that are in the room can ask questions. And a lot of times those filmmakers in there as well will ask questions. And it's a good learning experience for the filmmaker or screenwriter, because sometimes the perception that the audience gets is not what they intended based on what they presented. So when they're doing the acting out, one year we had someone said, everybody was laughing. And she said, I didn't intend for it to be a comedy, but it was the way the actors delivered the lines.
Oops.
Made it funny. So she said, maybe I better start writing comedies. And so that is one panel. And then we have a thing called the Digital Media Symposium, mm-hmm. which is a group of people who build games. They're in the gaming business. They build video games. And animation. So there's going to be animation workshop along with digital media and how games are created. So that's a big panel. We've done that for about 3 years now. Last 2 years ago, we had Mark Kirkland here, and he was part of that panel. Mark Kirkland was one of the original directors of The Simpsons. And he came and gave some of his expertise to our panel, and to our guests, of how The Simpsons was created. And he was the creator of Bart Simpson. So he was able to share some of that. We weren't able to record it because of copyright problems, but issues, but that was okay. The panel got a good feel for what it was about. And this year, we have another good panel, some animators as well, and have a group that's here from the Silicon Valley, California, that's going to be talking about gaming and the gaming industry. So that ought to be interesting. And we always have spontaneous panels sometimes. We have a, we also have, I forgot about this. We have a workshop called Safety for Sarah, and it's about safety on the set. The father of Sarah Jones, who was a young cinematographer who was killed during the production of Midnight Rider in Georgia, he has taken on, he has formed a nonprofit called Safety for Sarah, and he will be talking about film safety. And it's kind of on the heels of the most recent tragedy. That just happened. So that'll be an interesting panel. So there we get a lot in our 4 days done. And so we also have what they call the Indie Grants. South Carolina Film Commission sponsors a program called Indie Grants, which are grants made to South Carolina filmmakers. And you can get up to $30,000 if you submit, they have an open season where you submit your screenplay, and if it's accepted, then you get the grant, and then they assign producers and a lot of the behind-the-scenes people in a local school, their students, assist you in making your film, your short film. And it's only open to South Carolina residents, and it's the only program like it in the United States. So that happens on Saturday afternoon, and that's always a successful program. A lot of people don't know that. So the South Carolina Film Commission is here also to give a brief on making films in South Carolina. So
Nice.
It's an interesting time, and we get a lot of feedback from that.
Good. Ron, I just want to give a brief comment on what you said about the screenwriter. I sit on the board of advisors of a few film festivals, including ones about script competitions. And I've always told them, as far as scripts are concerned, it's very important to to ask the writers to focus on their pitch, the way they can give it. And I was in some sessions where we were reviewing pitches from screenwriters and helping them and guiding them. And it's so important because it just can break or make the film. Mm-hmm. If you, and I always think that if you're not capable of telling the pitch of your film, of your script, in works also for the finalized film, if you can't do it in less than, let's say, 45 seconds, there's a problem. Yeah. Yeah. And they don't work enough on that. And it's so, even when at the stage when they are submitting to festival, they should make the effort of being obliged, forced to give a pitch. Because that's one of the most important things. Anyway, but last question for you, Ron. Do you have considered adding an online component to your festival?
We have considered the online component, and I actually want to talk to a lot of the filmmakers this year. In past years, obviously pre-COVID, the filmmakers want to enjoy the experience of the in-person immediate feedback. And we try to make it as easy as possible. We work it out to where we comp the rooms. If we can get the filmmaker here, we tell them that a good many of them will have a complimentary hotel room for the entire period of the festival. And we also provide for them and all the filmmakers associated with their film, all events passes for the period of the festival. So that saves them a big expense. If they're traveling by air, then we can't afford to do all of that. But once we get them here, we want them to enjoy that experience, which you can't get with virtual. You can Zoom and all this, but you don't have that audience next to you, especially if it's a comedy or a drama that you want to see tears or you want to see laughter, then you don't have that. So I think there's probably a market for a hybrid kind of festival. The other reason is we consider our film festival also a tourism event. If they're not here, they're not in the restaurants and they're not in the hotels. And we almost feel like if we had a virtual component, then some of the people that have come here from our 39 states, for example, in 2020, we have people from 39 states and 5 countries. They may say, well, we'll just watch it online this time. So kind of the way Netflix and Amazon and all those are going now, a lot of people decided they'll wait for it to come out so they can watch it on in their living room rather than go into the multiplex or the cinema to see it. So we're kind of torn on that. And but I just think as long as we are able to have them in the building with us, it's a totally different atmosphere. And we're friends still with filmmakers who came here 16 years ago. Facebook and Twitter and all of those things have allowed us to stay connected, and we promote them. And we have what we call a BIF alumni that continue to come back. And once they've been accepted, they never have to pay an entry fee ever again. So we created a little family here. So so to answer your question, we're not strongly in favor of the virtual component.
All right. So next year I'll send you a couple of, I also, as my second hat, curate films with films I loved and for which I see the potential for being a festival darling. So I help them, guide them with the marketing in many aspects, including not limited to title, to poster, to marketing, to positioning, to you name it. And I open to them my pretty big network of festival directors. So Maybe next year you'll have a few from my best for fest. That's the name of my, my label.
That sounds good.
Anyway, Ron, I wish you a fantastic and very successful 16th. And start, I'm sure you're already starting thinking at the what's going next for 20th, preparing for the biggest celebrations. And anyway, so I love hearing what you said about your festival and wish every filmmaker the same success. Thank you so much, Ron.
Thank you. Thank you very much. Thanks for your time.
Thanks. So I'll be posting this to filmfestivals.com.
Okay. Thank you.
Thank you.
Bye-bye.
Bye.